I'm Terry Brownson, interim CEO, and today's in-service is kind of a combination. It's about values, and it is about person-centered practices also. So I'm just going to start a little bit on the values thing and move from there. You know, when we talk about values, there's all different kinds of values. And I'm not going to talk today about what's on the back of your badge. That's important that we can all look at the back of our badge. I want to just talk a little bit about what are values. And basically, values are things that are just deeply ingrained in us, deeply held kind of beliefs. They're things that we just hold really close to ourselves. Values are things that, in our mind, we don't want to compromise. I know sometimes when we value, when we violate our values, that's when we feel really bad. When we say, why did I do that? Why did I let that happen? Sometimes people have very distinctive and different values, and those values often come from how we raised, we're raised from our families. She says it works. Okay.
Some people just focus on
here to do my job. I'm not going to worry about anybody else. Other people are really in the teams and want to work with teams. How do we treat ourselves and what we expect from ourselves are really kind of a reflection of our own personal values. Some of us kind of don't have a very high opinion of ourselves. And others have really high goals and objectives for ourselves, what we want to accomplish in life. And all that has to do with how we were raised and what we think is really important in life. And of course, our values are also reflected in how we behave toward each other when we work. If we focus on supporting each other and covering for each other, or as I said, maybe it's I'm just here, it's every man for himself out there, and I'm just going to do the best I can and not worry about anybody else. Whether we think it's fine and good to have fun with each other and have fun at work, how can we make ways to have fun at work? Or are we kind of paranoid about each other? Paranoid about the next department over or stuff. After being gone 3 years, I come back and I see we used to always fight these silos. And I come back and I've seen silos creeping back in between groups. And that's part of we purposely say, sit with somebody different today, at least for an hour. Maybe get to know somebody else and their points of view. We only grow from that. Every business or company or agency or organization has values too. And those are kind of based on that corporate mission. I'm an old guy. I've worked a lot of different places, and I've worked at places where it was all about money. Yeah! And I've worked at that place. Has John been giving him lessons today? some places, it's big quality focus. It's all about quick sales and move on. Other places are really about building long-term customer loyalty and satisfaction. You see those kinds of things. And those values are then kind of reflected in what is the corporate culture that we have. And the corporate culture is kind of how a place goes about doing things. It's literally kind of the civilization. It's the daily life of that place. And ultimately, that culture is reflected in how all the different kinds of people that relate to that organization, how they interact with each other, and how they treat each other, be that the employees or the customers or whatever. Think about a place that you really like to go to. A restaurant, a store, maybe an organization you're part of, those types of things. Think about how you feel about that place. And if you feel good about that, if that's a place you'd like to go back to, a restaurant or whatever, that's a reflection on that company's values and how they believe they should treat you and your experience. How quickly you get waited on, how friendly the people are. That's all kind of a reflection of what that corporation has tried to instill and what's important to that kind of organization. Little Foster, of course, has corporate values, and they're based on our mission of empowering people to realize their dreams and potentials. Sometimes companies, organizations, corporations have what I call mission creep. And that's something I want to reflect on a little bit. Are we experiencing, experience and mission creep from that whole notion of that our real focus is empowering people with disabilities to realize their dreams and potentials. And so mission creep happens when sometimes you start moving away from the core values of why you're here, what you're supposed to be doing, kind of a losing sight of what our whole direction is. And so what happens when you have mission creep? That's when people just start saying, well, you know, Colin, there's lots of changes going on. What's going on? That certainty about what direction we're going, or the, you know, you hear this around, nobody ever tells me anything that's going on. People start losing track of what their job really is, or feeling like they are. What am I really supposed to be doing? What are people expecting out of me? What should I be focusing on first? And then it raises all these questions. Well, who's in charge? Who do I lead? Who can I look to? Who can I go to for help, for explanations, or support? And then ultimately what starts happening when you have mission creep is people start becoming suspicious of each other, losing that trust in each other. And a couple things will happen. They'll either start like seeking out other people that are kind of feeling the same way, or little cliques and groups, or in some cases, individuals just decide to go rogue. They just decide they're mad at everybody and not going to deal or align with anybody, and they just kind of start behaving real crazy in what they're talking about, who they're talking about, where they're going. When that kind of stuff happens, in order to be happy in your job, there's got to be that alignment of personal values and corporate values. It's really hard to find any work satisfaction if you're working in some place that their goals and values are just so inconsistent with yours. And I don't know about you, but I've worked places where I've felt like that. I've worked places that started one way and then they kind of started going the other way, where it moved from being all about the people to being all about the money. Or maybe I've taken a job where I thought I was working with a group of people that have certain values and found that maybe that wasn't where that was. So it's kind of really especially hard to be happy in your work if you don't say, hey, I'm digging what this place is trying to do and where it's time to go. And I feel like, you know, maybe I found a place here. Or if you're just saying, man, what's happening here is just so against my basic beliefs. You know, I just can't be happy. To me, the ultimate kind of question, and why this is really important to me, I'm about to turn 70. I've got a son with severe disabilities. That's 50. And I'm starting to realize, like a lot of parents with people with disabilities, parents with disabilities always believe they're going to outlive their child. It's just one of those things you want to hold tight to. I'm going to outlive what I'm always going to be. I'm starting to realize I may not. And I started having to think, where might my son end up? And I think those are questions that, even if you're not in that situation, you need to imagine. Would I use this service? Would I use one to foster myself? Would I place my son or daughter here? Do I believe in the people and the level of care? And to me, that's kind of the ultimate question when we talk about value alignment and us trying to operate a place that is consistent with those values. There's all kinds of values, that we can run through real quick. Like, it's like, how do you feel or how do you react when you're in a place where you're seeing these kinds of things? I won't go through the whole list of where people are saying, they're disinterested or disrespectful, or when it's obvious nobody takes any accountability own work, where people are dishonest, or where you experience all of these what I call isms, where just right from the beginning, you know, you're feeling, man, there's racism here, there's sexism here. Handicapism is one that we don't think too much about, but every time we go out in the community, I think people feel that, see that. And it's something that you have to even think about yourself when you are out with people. go out with people that you really feel positive about, to sit next to them, or do a bunch of the, if you're out with two or three other staff people, the staff people all over here, so that they can sit over there, and it's so clear that you're not associated with it. It's reflected on whether you're dragging somebody along behind you in a wheelchair, or whether you're with them and talking. You know, I see people dragging people along with their cell phone like that. You know, that's kind of a reflection that, hey, I'm separate from this person. I'm not equal. Don't let me get going on that. But those are kind of some negative values that we have to check ourselves on. On the other hand, maybe there are some positive values. You know, or is this the kind of place that you want to go in? Is this the kind of place that you feel good about? I'll just have to look at it real quick. Now, I hope you understand the difference in how these values are reflected. We learn to practice our values at a very early age. And this is just something that went through. You all have these. I call these adages, the things you pick up from your family. These are some things, and I wonder how many of y'all had one of your parents or one of your mentors or somebody preach this stuff to you. There's honor, there's value in all work. Don't look down on anybody. Every job's there for a purpose and a reason. And you can't look down on anybody for that. If it's worth doing, it's worth doing right. Some people say it's worth doing, it's worth doing right for the first time. The other hand, the balance, of course, balance of life. All work, my mom used to say, all work and no play makes you happy, no work. No pain, no gain. Two brains are better than one. I didn't realize at the time, but that's all about teamwork. You know, when you're trying to solve something, if you've got a problem, you know, relating to somebody, it takes two to have a fight. I fought my brother and I used to fight all the time, and we'd go someplace else to fight, because if we knew we fought in front of mom and dad, the answer was going to be we were both going to get in trouble, because it takes two to have a fight. You won't get anywhere unless you start, or unless you try, so you start faster. So we have stated values. I won't walk through these. We know what these are. We've seen it, and I think today's a good day for us to kind of think about these values and consider, is this something, these are worth us pursuing together? You know, to try to overcome issues and things, and it's time for us to move forward and start looking at those important kinds of things again. Person-centered practices kind of grow out of all of this. Some of you older people remember that when the training used to focus on normalization, and person-centered is kind of the next generation of moving toward those kinds of things. We really started on this path in 2012 when Michael Small, one of the gurus in the field, if you will, came, and we had a good number of board members as well as staff go through that very first training. And these are a core value. When I came back a couple months and a half ago, I don't know how long it's been, months, something like that, I wanted to confirm with the board that this was something that was a core value. And it is. And it's something that we may be struggling to live out some. We can talk the talk, but are we walking the walk? I mean, I know when I go around people, I've even heard things like person-centered is dead, or people are laughing about the concept. You know, it really is serious kinds of stuff about what we believe about ourselves and what we're trying to do here. You know, the second thing is empty values, and we need to think about that. If we don't live our own values, if we violate our own values, what does that say about us? If we don't live out Linda Foster's values, what does that say about Linda Foster? And as I said, because really the thing is, what do we have to do to really walk the walk, not just talk the talk? And that's where, you know, I think we are today, and where Sarah's going to go on into in terms of talking about the first and second thing. I guess, you know, on the test afterwards, I'm kind of asking for your input on three things. What core or personal values, and this is just kind of personal, you bring to Linda Foster in terms of some of your core beliefs about people and that, and what values do you think Linda Foster may be struggling with living out? I know there's been questions about, you know, are we living our values and other things that you're struggling with, and what then finally, what ideas might you have on how we can address some of that? So, that's my little preach for the day, and I'll turn it over to Sarah.
Okay, I don't want to say we're switching gears, because this is part of our culture, part of our value system, is person-centered practices, person-centered thinking. So we're just kind of digging in deeper with what person-centered thinking is and what's going on right now with Foster. That's why you guys are in groups. Most of the rest of this time is going to be you guys talking at your tables and then us talking as a group. So just a little bit of history real quick. And Terry just touched on this a little bit. But in April 2012, Michael Small came to Michael Foster, and they actually came before that and kind of evaluated us. They went to every department, evaluated how person-centered they thought we already were. And so then they came back in April and presented a 12-hour training, which a lot of you guys have been through. It was the same exact training in 2012 that we actually present today. And it was to all supervisors, and there were other interested staff in there. It wasn't all supervisors, so and board members as well were in there. Good. Okay. Coaches and leaders were then identified from this group that had nothing to do with supervisor level or anything like that. If you were interested in being either, and that was something that we did where they trained in coaches and then they trained in leaders. So we had that. Both groups received extra training. And then Wes Gaynor and Diane Caldwell, you've been here for several years, you know both of those names. They were then trained to be person-centered trainers, and they began to train more staff through the 2 days, the 12-hour, we now do it in 4 days. PC training and continued efforts to create the PC culture at Wendell Foster. Since day one, 484 people have gone through the 12-hour training here. Not all of those people work here. We have trained some people who actually came in, and we trained them so that they could go back to where they work and take those practices with them, which is pretty cool that we were spreading that outside of Little Foster. But I think that's a pretty big number. I know it's over 5 years, but 484 people have been trained through Little Foster and person-centered practices. Currently, 217 staff have gone through 12-hour training. So raise your hand if you've been through it. Okay, so quite a few of you guys. As of right now, we have 55 coaches. We ended up combining leaders and coaches over time, so now we only have coaches. It is not the same thing as a support team coach, by the way. That gets confused sometimes. This is a person-centered coach. And we are about to start training in more, which Wes Gaynor and I will be the trainers for that. Okay. Any questions so far? Even if you have not been through the 2 day or 12-hour training, it is okay. Everybody should be able to answer these questions. Hopefully, if you haven't been through the training, you have heard of person-centered practices, you've heard of person-centered thinking, whether it's positive or negative, whether it's, like Terry said, it's dead, or maybe you see it in where you're working, and you said, well, it's definitely not dead. We're doing all these cool things because of, you know, this different mindset. So what I want you guys to do, and what nothing, you know, whatever it is. Where do you feel like you have failed at integrating PC into culture a little faster? So where have we failed at that? And then where do you feel like we have accomplished positive change because of the person-centered culture? So those three things, I know they're pretty big questions. We'll take about 5-6 minutes to talk about that. Okay? So just discuss what you say. Somebody at each table, be like a reporter. Write down some things that you'll say out loud. then if we want to talk about it as a group, depending on what it is, we can talk about it. All right, so let's start right here.
Even though we do get people out, we have time limits on them. So you have pushing our individuals through whatever activity it is that they're enjoying, and then that makes them not want to go out again. Something else that I mentioned before, SEO and other colleges, you know, y'all have a one-to-one ratio, one SEO, and then maybe 3-to-1. So that can be a little hard at times, but that's when we have great clients that come up and do what we need to do. So that's one of the main things that we focus on.
Okay, so time restraints could be holding us back a little bit. And I think that comes into play as well with shift changes. I know when I worked in the ICF, it was harder because, you know, especially when you leave at 3 o'clock or you leave at 6 o'clock or whatever, it's like, okay, well then we have to be back by 6, or we have to be back, you know, we have to be back. So it's kind of the same, you know, yeah, time restraints and not being able to go past those hours for one reason or another.
Yep.
STL loves to talk, apparently. Marlon. How long's Marlon been here?
22 years.
Oh, no.
Pretty quick. We're, you guys good for Yale? What do you want?
quality of life and experiences for those in the person center. Fair people to be able to kind of think outside the box and come up with more creative things, whether it's helping someone be able to ride on that airplane or do these different things. You know, we've really been able to think outside the box. Sometimes it can be hard, especially for a lot of people we serve have so many basic needs and medical needs and stuff, and those have to be addressed, and we have a little time left to work on those person-centered, more fun and more meaningful experiences for those people, and then you're kind of faulted for that because you didn't get to that today, and I just think that people are a little overwhelmed and don't have enough help to do some of that, whereas from a therapy perspective, I get person one-on-one for that time, and I can work just on that. I'm not having to meet all those other needs. We just feel that what we all feel that person is just still looking at what's important to and for, and how each person on the team can help support that goal. We, a lot of us still kind of understood that basic foundation.
Thank you. Just what you're doing.
We discussed that overall we felt like person-centered training or person-centeredness was going well in those aspects, but there were times that there was a breakdown.
Good. All right. See?
things is how we empower and make changes to the 24-hour schedule, individual rituals and routine. And a specific example of that is organized working together, reschedule Thursdays to better accommodate individuals' needs or college requests. That's the positive side. This table talks about some things that we failed at, and it was mentioned that in conferences that we discuss more the not working, important twos, positive reputations and things. Another thing is new staff coming in. This table has said that we're not seeing much one-page profiles being used.
Okay.
So the new staff aren't coming in seeing the individual one-page profiles, not seeing their covers.
So obviously you're going to want it to be enjoyable while you're here. Facebook, Twitter, employee handbook. If you still don't get Wendell Foster text messages, I sent one this morning, remind you to come today. Text at Wendell F to 81010. Promise, you got it? Good. If you don't want those text messages, that's fine, but I do send you updates. So that's something that you're going to miss out on if you don't do that. We have an in-service in September. It is Wednesday the 20th and Thursday the 21st. That wasn't on the original master schedule. We ended up adding the health fair to October, so we backed up infection control in September. All right, so Kim Trainer, I'm sure, is your favorite person to see up front for infection control. She will be up here on the show in September.
Yes, ma'am.
You got to write a report. Yes, Marla. No, in all seriousness, we really need you guys here. It's hard to have good discussion. Imagine what this makeup is going to look like for people who watch the video and they don't get to have table discussion. It really is important for you all to be here. And honestly, if infection control is only going to last 15 minutes, we might talk about more person-centered stuff after it. So it really is important for you all to be here if you can. Obviously, some people can't, you're on vacation, something like that. Send me an email, send me something on their app, send me something, or let your supervisor know, have them email me the reason, and we'll do makeups. Yes, Marla?
Terry, snack time be bring some cookies and some brownies.
Marla, we can't do any bad food until after the health screening in October, okay? We're trying to help you guys out. Contacted them, we don't want to harass them. So check that out on the file, see who you've already contacted.